Okay, so let's start. Okay, today we're honored by having Professor Giannakis. Hello? Okay, so today we're honored having Professor Giannakis from the University of Minnesota. Professor Giannakis holds two endowed chair positions. The first one is chair in wireless communications, and the second endowed chair position is University of Minnesota McKnight Presidential Chair in ECE. He serves as the director of the Digital Technology Center. This is a prestigious and very successful research center that has more than 50 faculty from different disciplines. Professor Giannakis' areas of expertise span communications, networking, statistical signal processing, and currently he works on data science and network science. He has published over 450 journal publications and over 750 conference papers, 25 book chapters, and two edited books. He holds 33 issued US patents, and he received 9 best journal awards from the IEEE Signal Processing and Communications Societies. He also received the Technical Achievement Awards from Signal Processing Society in 2000 and EuroSIB in 2005, and the inaugural IEEE Fourier Technical Field Award in 2015. He's a fellow of EuroSIB, and he served the IEEE in various posts, including distinguished lecturer. Professor Giannakis is one of the most cited professors. He has over 72,000 citations with an H index of 143. So please welcome him.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is my pleasure to be here. And I appreciate the invitation extended by the Dean's Office with the suggestion of the ECE Chair, Professor Abdel Motalem. And I have enjoyed my stay over the day immensely. I have old friends, Professor Chiodun Tsai, who has worked in our group. And made new friends since 10 o'clock in the morning. For those of you that have happened to be in another colloquium or keynote I have delivered, typically my talks have a lot of equations. This one went on the other side to have minimal or no equations. So because it's supposed to appeal to the general audience, that corresponds to the Dean's seminar series. All right, so feel free to interrupt me anytime you want. I'm going to talk about data science and network science. And I will give an outline of the challenges and the opportunities that emerge in these contemporary fields from the vantage point of someone that is in machine learning or signal processing. And after this general introduction, I'll tell you at a high level some of the topics we have touched upon in my research group over the last 6-8 years that have worked on this. So, you've heard about this buzzword of data science and big data. So your first question is, what is exactly data science? Difficult to give definitions, but I attempted one. It's a data-driven toolbox in order to help the discovery of patterns or laws along but also beyond those that are developed by physics. Then the second question you may want to ask is, how about big data? How big are big data? That's another question. The answer here comes with, it depends. It depends on the computing platform. Why? Because whatever, inverting a 10 by 10 system of equations, a matrix which is 10 by 10, maybe a piece of cake for your cell phone. But if I tell you invert a million by a million matrix, then that could challenge your desktop. And a billion would challenge also your mainframe or supercomputer, great supercomputer. But it is useful to reflect on the fact that as we speak in Earth, there are 6 billion cell phones and 30 billion posts per month on Facebook. That's big. And it's also useful to reflect, as far as your job prospects are concerned, that there is a 40% of growth of data versus 5% growth in IT spending per year. So those numbers will lead me naturally to the next question. Good to have big numbers, but is there anything on the intellectual merits and on the impact of big data? And again, my answer is three-pronged. Certainly, research in this area can benefit another various domains. That includes social sciences, biosciences, health, autonomous vehicles, multimedia, marketing businesses, secure cyberspace, just to list a few of those fields that can benefit directly. So research is a clear case. Definitely there is value added. I'll give you an example. It has been estimated that there will be a $300 billion boost in U.S. healthcare alone if you take advantage of machine learning and data science. That's the projected benefit. And to relate to the country that is near and dear to me as much as this country, this is twice the GDP of Greece. But also in education, as we speak, many or most universities around the US at least and North America are pursuing a data science-centric effort to upgrade their programs. Several of them give degrees, undergraduate degrees in data science. So you have three directions, research, value added, and education that justify the front cover of The Economist, which says that we indeed live in an era of data deluge. And given the three answers I gave you, you would agree with me that the popular science cover as well is pertinent. So there are a lot of data, and data is power. So taking advantage of them makes sense. So what are the challenges? Together with big data come big challenges as well. The first one comes from the fundamental theory. So you deal with data that entail high dimensional attributes, and there is an urgent need for parsimonious models to ease interpretability and also enhance predictive performance. I promised to say we have minimal equations, but at least I have a linear equation. So many times you have to face solutions of systems of linear equations that could have millions of unknowns. So this x there could be 1 million by one vector. And being able to invert it can be facilitated if you take advantage of the structure of this matrix X. There are efforts in recent years that take advantage of the fact that this X is sparse, so it does not have many non-zero entries. That alone can be helpful, can help you reduce the complexity of an algorithm. So algorithms in real time are needed, and not only computing, but also even acquisition, processing, and storage of big data becomes a major challenge. But even visualizing, if I tell you, can you visualize the trends of millions of voters in a campaign, right? That's not easy to visualize, even if you put dots. But also mining, and do it in a way that respects privacy and security constraints. That's also a big challenge. For sure, big data come in high dimension. If you visualize them as vectors or matrices, their dimensions are high. But also there are many, the vectors themselves or the matrices are many. So the volume as well as the dimension is huge. And people call about different Vs in addition to volume, the variety of the data or the velocity or the veracity of the data that they become available. And for the soccer enthusiasts, with big data come anomalies. And they're anomalous and incomplete. And the reason that I test your knowledge of soccer is that it's an anomaly to misspell the messy name with a Y. The correct spelling has an I here. So, but this happens. It has happened in very well-known sports magazine. So, but together with big challenges come big opportunities. And the big opportunities show up in different directions. For example, there is an evident shift from vectors and matrices to tensors that can collect high-dimensional models. And relevant factorizations become all of a sudden of interest. So there is a need for questioning the theoretical and statistical foundations of big data analytics and discovering new algorithms for low-dimensional data or resource trade-offs. For example, if you have to deal with big data, you may be able to sacrifice in accuracy so that you can gain in speed of representation. Maybe speed accuracy is not as important. So you can explore sweet spots in the emerging trade-offs in processing and accuracy. In addition, when it comes to algorithms and implementation platforms, again, we need to learn from massive data sets. And there are novel architectures that emerge that have to be also robust to outliers and missing data. Some of these aspects I will touch upon in the rest of the talk. But at this point, I want us to go back and reflect on the title I chose for this talk. I said data science and network science, right? I chose these two. Why? Is it accidental? Not exactly. They're related. Why? Because networks produce huge amounts of data. And networks also are used to capture interdependencies among things that we want to compute. So I will try to illustrate these points in the next two slides. So remember, networks produce a lot of data, much more than individual nodes. All right. The smarter our devices become, the more data traffic they generate. If you go back to gaming consoles, they were 42 times not less smartphone. Then we went to the smartphone times 50, tablet times 120, and our cell phone nowadays is like a laptop. And that corresponds to 360, 400 times the data that is being generated by an old phone. But now, especially with the Internet of Things, and communication networks entail interconnected smart devices and that are basically providing services, commercial, consumer-oriented, and oftentimes heterogeneous services. And if you look at the growth across years, this is 2016, and what is projected for 2021, 5 years later. So from 4.9 billion smartphone users, we're going to go to 5.5 billion. And more mobile videos from 60% of the traffic. These account for 60% of the traffic. Now they will grow to 78% of the traffic. And if you want to see it in hexabytes per month, the growth is truly exponential. And for those of you that don't know what's an exabyte, it's 10 to the 18. Huge number. Okay? So compare what's happening, what was happening in 2014, 2.5 exabytes per month. Now we are an order of magnitude in 2019. That's where we stand right now. An order of magnitude of what's happening, what was happening in 2014 in terms of hexabytes per month. So unquestionably, networks generate a lot of data. But networks are extremely useful for a number of things. They connect people, such as the networks and the graphs we use to model networks of friends, social networks, but also traditional wireless or wireline connected devices in the internet. But also energy grids are interconnected, right? And things that are less traditional, such as financial markets. Countries are transferring funds to one another, and that reflects their economic status and their trends. And brain networks are an area of increasing importance, in neuroscience in particular, but also we have networks that govern the interconnections of genes and proteins. Now, the toolboxes, the tools that are used to address problems in these different areas constitute, the common denominator of these constitute what we refer to as network science. So to understand basically the underlying physics of networks and tools that can cross-fertilize benefits from whatever we know in, let's say, social networks or the internet to brain networks. Again, the scale is massive. We talked about Facebook with 115 user, billion users. And the other thing that I didn't say, that sometimes the connectivity of genes can change with time, or even social networks can change with time. You add friends, remove friends, right? So networks also change dynamics. Being able to capture and track the dynamics of changing topologies of the network is a major challenge. Many data come in a streaming form, and in huge numbers as well. This, they estimate that approximately there are 6,000 tweets per second. Tweets per second. And let me add to it as a joke that this is before Trump, you know, took over. So in addition, due to privacy constraints, you may not want to reveal your friends, right? So you have unobservable links. That's another major challenge when you deal with networks. And what is desired is a number of parsimonious models that capture adequately the network structure, and they're able to track it, as well as efficient algorithms to discover patterns and laws from these interconnections. For those of you that want to pursue a degree or a research path in these areas, let me tell you that these two areas, data science and network science, lie at the crossroads of statistics, optimization, what people like to call machine learning, signal processing, and networking. So you got to have background interests in those areas to build on these areas that I mentioned. So that's a good point to stop and ask for possible questions that you may have. What is data science? What are some of the challenges? What are the opportunities for research and development? And how data science relates with network science? Remember, we said networks produce a lot of data. And also we said that network science reveals interdependencies between interconnected agents or points. Okay? So they come also with challenges and opportunities. So do we have any question on that generic line of introduction to the area? If not, I picked up just three different areas. If I have time, I can also talk about power networks. But I suppose these three classes will give you some idea of what you can do with this problem. So I will talk a little bit about social networks and how to identify topologies of social networks. So who is connected with who? And then I'll talk about detecting communities and flagging anomalies or outliers, they're called sometimes. So there's something wrong in a network. How can you identify anomalies? Then I'll talk a little bit about how these things can manifest themselves in gene regulatory or brain networks. And finally, I'll talk a little bit about communication networks. Okay. So let's talk about social networks. There are certain carriers, if you like, that are called contagions in this field, that on which information propagates. And this could mean popular news stories, infectious diseases among drug users, or diseases of buying too much or buying too little, whether you are in a retailer or a family member that suffers from elevated costs in credit card accounts. So the interesting thing is, what is common through all of this is that the information propagates through in cascades over implicit networks. Okay, so drug users, for example, they share needles, or news agents, they broadcast or retweet, right? So the issue is, can you identify the hidden graph topology, which could be used subsequently, for example, for viral advertising or developing a healthcare policy, right? And then can you identify anomalous nodes which you help you identify or reveal or unveil spam or fake news or identify discovered terrorist cells. Okay, let me start with some work we did 5 years ago. And this was to model relationships among nodes through linear but time-varying equations. So on the left-hand side, you have y that represents the infection time of node I by contagion C during time of interval t. So let's take an example. Suppose that we have a piece of news which basically says Trump impeached. Right, that's the contagion, the mem. That's the Y. The contagion is C, I'm sorry. I is the node, so you have the Washington Post, is a news agency, right? posted at on, let's say our T interval is a day on November 18. It posted that note. Now, we postulate here that this is a linear combination of all other nodes that are affiliated with Washington Post, and the combination coefficients at time t are what graph theorists call the adjacency metrics. So node I and node j has a link, and it has a weight. That link has a weight. Now, the Washington Post may be connected with the Herald Tribune, what have with the news office of the White House, and so on. So here what we say is that whatever the Washington Post posted is a linear combination of its connections, plus external influences. For example, you know, this is a political new piece of news. So if it was it's connected with some sports newspaper, that's irrelevant. So, and this is noise to model unknown dynamics. So this is a two-index variable. That means if I collect all nodes, all i's, and all contagions, then I build a matrix y, and I keep a subscript t to denote the time. So I measure y and I measure x, and this is like a least squares problem, where my problem is, after I'm given the data xt and yt, I want to track the topology and the external influences bt. Why do I track the topology? Why estimating A implies connectivity, presence or absence, if A, the entry of A, matrix A, let's say the entry 3, 4 is 0. That means node 3 is not connected with node 4. So the moment I tell you that some of them are non-zero, then I can reveal the topology. Now, this particular problem is challenging because it's playing catch up. The time, the unknown depends with time. So every time slot that I get new data, I get new unknowns. So it cannot be solved. It's a nil-posed problem without extra assumptions. So the question is, can we model this dynamical evolution? And how do we model evolving topologies? We came up with two models. One is to say that topology is very slow, which is meaningful, right? You don't change friends on Facebook every hour or every day. You may change after a month or so, right? So basically, that means that the A for a certain T remains the same. So you can accumulate enough equations. That's one model. The other model says that they can switch among known discrete states. So you can see here in a major debate, liberals and conservatives retweet network in a major debate, they are polarized. But during ordinary times, they are mingled, they are the same. So that means in this particular example with a picture, we have two states, either, you know, election period or not election period, right? So then if you tell me that the A is between two A's, then you reduce the number of unknowns. So we managed to solve major problems of tracking topologies of networks using this simple structural equation model, as it's called. And we have demonstrated its use in tracking the rise of Kim Jong-un, a very controversial gentleman here, individual, I should say. We looked at how many websites tracked his name, 360 websites, and we monitored 466 cascades over 45 weeks. And at the 10 weeks, these websites that are represented by the red dots here were sparsely interconnected. But after 40 weeks, the connection became very, very dense. And if you map the total number of edges versus time, you will see that they correspond to major events. So because after week number 28, this gentleman was appointed as vice chairman of military commission. And after week 37, he killed his uncle, Kim Jong-il. And of course, then afterwards became the ruler of North Korea. And you can map exactly the network density of mentioning him with what he is doing. And then in addition to using these models for identifying the network topology, which is changing even, we also used it to detect communities. And because the communities can be huge, we devised random sampling of large networks, which can be used to validate how data can be grouped in different clusters. So here I'm demonstrating some real data from the Journal of General Relativity. These are primarily physicists that publish in this journal. And they are grouped in different groups. And the state of the art, which is known as spectral clustering, takes, in order to cluster these 4,000 nodes, which is not huge, but still not low, with 13,000 so edges and 36 clusters. So this one was done in 3.1 seconds, and we managed to reduce it to half a second with an algorithm that people called SKEVA, sketch and validate algorithm. So there are ways of taking points in space and being able to group them very efficiently. In addition to that, you can also unveil anomalies or outliers in networks. How do you do that? The examples are clear, right? You have email spammers, cyber criminals, or terrorist cells. And our idea was to, although the network may be huge, we can try to detect nodes using their EgoNet features. The EgoNet of each node includes the number of edges that emanate from this node, its centrality, its betweenness, the number of neighbors of neighbors, different characteristics of each node. So we put them one after the other, and we have a vector for each node. So our approach is to leverage the structure of the network and come up with algorithms that identify the nominal nodes and the outlying nodes. So basically, if all this data were collected in a matrix Y, and we only sample a subset of this, then we can postulate that the matrix Y comprises a low rank matrix X, which is the nominal, and the outliers that destroy the nominal rank and unmodeled dynamics in the error matrix R. So using state-of-the-art methods of identifying low rank plus sparse matrices, because the idea is that the nominal matrix, if business as usual nodes have low rank, but whenever you add an outlier, which is also a sparse matrix, because an outlier, if it was not sparse, would be an inlier or nominal, right? So using these properties, it is possible to separate, to identify the non-zero entries of O, and these places where you have a non-zero entry of O reveal which nodes are anomalous. So, for those of you to appreciate that this is not an easy problem, let's forget about the noise E. So someone gives you Y, right? And tells you, find the X and the O. You have to appreciate the fact that this is a challenging problem in general, because you are given the sum and you are trying to find the summons, right? Indeed, if I give you 12, 12 can be 8 plus 4, it can be 11 plus 3, it can be 10 plus 2, it can be minus 13 plus 25, infinite solutions, right? So, but the fact that you have sparsity and low rank and sparsity makes that possible, this separability possible, it turns out. It's not obvious perhaps, but we have theory to support that recovery. But here I'm demonstrating it through, again, a general relativity co-author. So these are all the lines are basically points, authors, or papers, or sorry, papers. And when they co-author some, there are common authors in two papers that are connected. And then you can see that there are, even in general relativity, outlier researchers, that means very good researchers, that many people cite them and co-author papers with them. All right? I want to take that step, one, that notion of outliers, one step further. And if you notice here, I have put the word outliers in quotes. And the reason I have done that is to stress that the outliers are not necessarily the bad guys. They're guys that are different. There's a famous statistician by the name Jenkins, Box. And this guy said that all models are wrong, except some of them are useful. Okay? So you can imagine that the moment that your errors, you have something different in a nominal environment, this different can be the point of interest. And I demonstrate that with one of our works on robust PCA, principal component analysis. It is basically the background of an image tends to be a low rank matrix. You know, an image is a matrix that reflects the gray levels, right? Even a black and white image, right? It's a pixel that reflects the gray level. So if this is, by the way, data from a camera, surveillance camera. So these are the data we got from the surveillance camera. Actually, we get many more. We got 520 images like that. I just put three. So we take now an image, and we make it a long vector of size 19, almost 20,000. Okay? And we apply the principal component analysis. And if you apply the principal component analysis, that helps you move out the outliers, which are the people in the scene. You remember that we have 520 snapshots, right, in the video. So when people pass by, they leave the principal component, which is the background. Okay? But you see, it's not very clear here. It shows some leftovers. But when we apply a robust PCA using the outliers, the O that you saw earlier, it not only cleans up the background extremely well, compare these two, but also the outliers, in quotes, are the people that pass. So the outlier is not necessarily the background that you may not be interested about, but it may be the innovation that you are interested, like the people. A surveillance camera You want to see whether, you know, Professor Tsai crossed this gate in the airport, right? And you have a picture of him. Then you scan over the database. So you see, can I see that picture there? Okay? So, that's what I had about social networks. And now I would move to chat a little bit about gene regulatory networks and brain networks. Any question on the social network? Yes.
I think there is a connection between network science and data science, which is called network embedding. So embedding nodes into vectors such that some machine learning techniques can be applied to the network.
You can sit. You don't have to stand. Yeah, go ahead.
So can you give some comments on that? So how can those network embedding techniques apply to dynamic networks and the multi-layer or multiplex networks?
Very good question. Okay. For those of you that do not understand the question, I will use the word embedding, because the key word is embedding, right? The whole idea is, imagine that you have an interconnected network. What the computer scientists say is that, okay, I can tell you that you don't need network science. You can take this interconnected network and place a vector sitting on each node. Associate with it a vector. If you think about it, another practical example which explains this notion that she's pointing out is the following. Suppose that I give you 5 points, right, in space, and you only know their Euclidean distances. Now that's easy through cell phones, right? Receive signal strength. So I can find the distances. Can you place them on the map where they are, if you know distances? The word place them on a two-dimensional plane corresponds putting a two-dimensional vector in it. You are embedding at every point the two-dimensional vector that describes the XY coordinates, right? And if it's in 3D, then it's a three-dimensional vector. So you can take, with this example, something that looks like a graph and map it to a bunch of vectors. And then she says, well, this is called embedding. That's correct. And then, one, you can take the embedding. They're very popular in machine learning these days, node embeddings. And if you hear graph neural networks or graph convolutional networks. However, there is a major problem, two major problems, I would say. One major problem is that who told you the embedding dimension? Because in visualization problems that I just brought up, your dimension is either 2 or 3, right? You cannot visualize things in 4 dimensions, right? Well, at least I cannot. We cannot. Okay. So, should I put 5 or 6, 7 or 8? And you know, depending on how many dimensions you're going to put, your results are going to change. If you use your, so that's one issue. The second issue is that you don't unveil the inner structure of the interconnection. And you tend to be computationally much more expensive than if I can do it using the network properties. If I can solve, for example, the community detection problem with my network properties, I would rather not go. Because the corresponding part of what she said is, you want to find communities in a network? Once you have vectors, then you can do clustering, or you know, in data vectors. So basically, unknown dimension is one, and complexity is the second. Good question. Any other one? Okay, let's touch a little bit on gene regulatory and brain networks. Okay, here is another popular model that we broadened in many different ways, but it's sufficiently simple for me to say it here rather than tell you about our generalization. So I put a network here, and although I have put these dots regularly, like they're sitting on a grid, they don't have to sit on a grid. But I did that in order to also allow for time variations. So here, if you look at this, vertical line, is my network. I put one node after the other. It doesn't have to be that way, but I put it one after the other to be able to plot it in a single slide. Okay? So these are the networks at time t. And this is the network at time t minus 1. Okay? The network at t minus 2, blah, 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 t minus l, lag, l for lag. So there is a beautiful class of models that they are known as linear structure vector autoregressive models. And basically, they're governed by this equation, which is similar to the one I showed you earlier, except that here is what I do, right? I'm sitting at an, I'm sorry, I should explain the interconnections before telling you the equation. Okay, what is the interconnection here? So different nodes are connected with one another, and I want you to, with the blue. This is at the same time slot, right? At the T slot. And I want you to notice that I also allow for directions. So that means node, in my example, node 4 influences 5. That means from 4 to 5. But also 5 can influence 4, right? Can be bidirectional. It can be one directional. From 4, I have dependency to 1, and from 1 to 2, right? So these arrows reveal potential connections, okay? But that one also reveals links with the past, the red lines. So what I'm saying here is that, for example, this node, let's say the first node, is affected by the previous first node and by two nodes before. So these are the red lines, okay? So we understand the interconnection and how the graphic. Then we are ready to understand the equation. So I postulate that if I'm sitting at a J node over here, my value that I measure here is a linear combination of all other nodes that I'm interconnected, because if I'm not connected, this adjacency weights will be zero. And also, I'm writing a superscript L that to signify the lag. I may be connected even with legs, even with myself, but at previous time points. If you want, the first component captures interdependencies in space, and the second one captures also interdependencies in time. Is that clear? The problem is the following. The point, let me clarify what I said already. The edges capture directed causal dependencies, and what helps us solve this problem is that the edges and the interconnections relative to the number of nodes are not that many. So there is edge sparsity. So only a few of these AIJs are non-zero. Okay. So let me say what is the effort here and how it relates to brain networks or things of that nature. So here, whatever I measure, y, I measure y, and I'm trying, this is model dynamics noise. So I measure the y's, and I'm trying to find the a's. So if I can solve this problem, then I can tell you who is connected with who affects current networks from past, whether there are two-way interconnections, and things like that. Okay, this is a very popular paper on this. It's very, very well used, this structural vector autoregressive models in neuroscience. What we did was to question the linearity, because this one says that y at J know that type T is a linear combination. And we said, why linear? So we developed nonlinear dependencies farms, which are not only directional also, but also tractable and interpretable. Okay? But to keep my presentation at the level that can be followed, I will just give you the result in two directions. So this is discovering gene regulation. So the data that we have here are gene expression levels, all right? And here you're trying to, this is a linear structured regressive model, the linearity. So it discovers this connections. So it says that this gene regulates that one, and so on. Then we did our method using Gaussian kernels, and our ways of introducing linearity is through kernel theory. And then what we did, what we discovered is that not only we can discover the links that were discovered by the linear, but also new connections that were not discovered by the linear. So new causal links have been identified, and this could help perhaps understand gene functions and cellular dynamics. And ultimately, related methods can be used to design gene targeting drugs and therapies, what we call also will facilitate or promote or support the desirable personalized medicine tasks. Let me talk a little bit now about brain networks. Our brain is divided in different regions and have different names. And the effort of brain networks is to understand the connectivity of brain functions, what part of the brain localizes the region of the brain that are activated during a given task. Okay? So for now on, you can think of different parts of the brain and node as nodes of a network, right? So the ultimate goal is to treat, cure, and prevent brain disorders, including Alzheimer's disease. Okay. So that was my target. My mom had that problem. And I took a look at some real data that we had. We picked up from Mass General Hospital. There is a human connectome project in Minnesota that is designed, that we were included to come up with models for the network connectivity. And I'm showing you here the results that we came up with. First, what were the data? The data from Boston were acquired with electrocorticography, or ECOG, for epilepsy. I don't want to describe the experiment, but suppose that someone puts an electrode in your brain, at different parts of your brain, pretty much like when you wear this helmet in ECG, right, and they record activities of your different parts of your brain across time, okay? So we use these vectors that were sitting on each, and these vectors now were the Ys that you saw in the previous, right? And we used our nonlinear models to establish connectivity, and what you show here is the connectivity before the epilepsy, pre-ictal, and after the epilepsy. So this grid here are the different electrodes, right? What they were recording, and that correspond to the different regions. So what you can observe here is that the information diffusion is inhibited after the onset of an epileptic seizure. That something we know. But we saw it here. This is with a linear swarm. But when we applied nonlinear, then this corresponds to these two. The nonlinear is here. So what we see here is a multi-kernel learning approach reveals many more connections, which actually include the connections, all the connections that the linear can predict, but includes more. But again, the same trend goes down. The diffusion of information is inhibited in both cases. So that basically shows how network science tools can reveal connectivity and also tell you what happens if there is a seizure, what connections are lost. And this is when I told you about the tools of the structure, namely the rank and the sparsity, we applied this to study dynamic cardiac MRI. And here I'm showing an in vivo data set. This is the real image. And this is the sampling trajectory. So basically, we showed that if you leverage the structure, low rank and sparsity of outliers of the image, even if you subsample an image, this is how the subsampling occurs, then you can reconstruct an image which is of comparable quality with 10% of the data that are acquired to come up with this true image. And if you ask, so what? You know, there's many people that are afraid of getting into the tube to be imaged. And the doctor, actually, whenever you stay for a long time, the images oftentimes are not as good because they're blurred. So instead of 30 minutes, if I can get a comparable quality in 3 minutes, that's a huge improvement, one-tenth, right? So that is basically by exploiting the low rank to lower the sampling rate. So I guess I've approached the end, but I can give you just one thing to cover the communication problem as well. So anomalies in communications pertain to changes in origin-destination flows. And the anomalies can come because of failures, congestions, denial of service attacks, intrusions or flooding. So again, we model things with a graph, G that has N nodes, L links, and F flows. Flow is the voice or the picture you send to your friend over the wireless network. So the number of flows that we send is many more than the links. And the origin destination flow variables is depicted by Z for flow F at time slot T. So basically, here is a toy example to describe what is how things look like. Here I'm showing a network that has a few nodes and two flows, the greenish flow from origin from this origin to that destination, and the reddish flow, F2, from this origin to this destination. Suppose that I sit at the link L and I count the packets. How many packets traverse this link L? So the number YLT is the number of packets at L at time slot T. So it's a superposition of flows. How many flows traverse this link? And to figure out how many flows traverse this link, I use this binary variable RLF, which is the routing matrix variable, and it is zero if the flow F does not go through link L. Plus, some bad guy may have inserted anomalies, okay? So if you take this scalar equation and you collect all the links, because you cannot measure all the links, right? But you collect them in a vector, you get a vector that has all the links, so it's a YT vector. And if you compare all the time slots and you put them in a matrix, then you have a YT matrix. So again, you have a problem like this. You have a YT matrix is a routing matrix and Z plus A. You are interested to identify the anomalies, and you are given the Y and the routing matrix, R. The routing matrix is fat, so you cannot invert, and that makes the problem challenging. But we have managed to come up with an algorithm that identifies the anomalies. And we have implemented this in real data, Internet 2 backbone network data. This is detection probability. This is false alarm probability. The closer to one, the better. We are the red, and the competition from AT&T that knows the number of outliers is that black line. So what I'm showing here is the anomaly volume. So I can tell you in which flow and at what time you had an anomaly. That was the basically the spiky characteristics of this plot. So where is this useful? You can have a depiction of the network health across flows and across time. So I'll skip the rest of it, and I would like to finish with this picture. But first, I wanted to ask myself what you may have perhaps asked yourselves during my talk. Are these theoretical results and algorithms that important for the network science and data science? And my answer will come through an IEEE advertisement, Spectrum News, that I received about a year ago. And this is what the story is from England. There were 450, almost a million women that missed breast cancer screenings due clearly to an algorithmic failure in UK. So that's important. If I can come up with theory and algorithms that can reduce this number, then it can have a real impact, right? And that concludes my talk. And on the last slide, I will tell you that if you like parts of this talk, then you should give credit to these guys that are behind the scenes. There are several of my students that through the years, one way or the other, contributed to it. And if you don't like anything, then you should blame it on me. So I am glad to open the floor for further questions you may have.
Any questions?
Give us some
predictions about future development in the data science area. Crystal ball. I was just thinking that very soon we. I mean, I have a nephew, right? So I was telling him that he was asking me, what did he ask me? A related question. I'll tell you what. He said basically, yes. He asked me, I told him that many things that now you take for granted, like a cell phone, many times ago, we didn't have cell phones, and we could not share this. That was the conversation. So then he asked me, like you know, can you tell me what my kids will not know that, will not have that I have? You know, and what I told him is that most likely your kids down the road will not go shopping, because you will not have shops. You, most of them will be delivered to your door through Amazon type. What is very really exciting, it's a really exciting period for a number of fields. In addition to, I happen to be, through my background, more into theory and algorithms, but also I draw great satisfaction when I see a problem being solved in real life. So I'll just say that Berkeley, UC Berkeley, I visited last year, and they told me that they are preparing an announcement for a college of data science. So a college of data science, that means many departments. And I said, oh, wow, what do you mean? You know, how can you have departments? They said, okay, now there are no departments, but it is obvious that, you know, in every school or every department you go, there's a bunch of faculty, a subset. Sometimes it's less than 20%, sometimes it's maybe more. But they like to do something with data science, data analytics, machine learning. So for example, you know, sorting out fake news, right, or public policy issues, or historical facts or patterns. And as data science penetrates to different application domains, then the impact backwards will be at least as significant. So there are a lot of things to be discovered from data. Okay. And I think that the future will be very surprising as soon as, or whenever we come to collect the benefits that data-driven science has to offer. So that's, I think, the next thing.
Any other questions?
So yes, sir.
Do you see data science becoming like its own, like people have their own data science firms, whereas like I look online and say for jobs, I see where people are looking for data scientists, but I don't actually see data science firms where all the people there are data scientists and they're like working in conjunction with like a hedge fund or something like that.
Yeah, I understand. There are actually three types of data science job markets. One is the pure data science, and this is your Google, Amazon, Facebook. Is data science, pure data science. But your NextEra here, you call it Florida Light and Power. Power and Light. You know, employs a lot of people to do data analytics, to predict, you know, power consumption, categorize customers, and so on. So these are more of the application domains. But the pure data analytics are those like related to e-commerce, for example, 100%. So, but you're right. I mean, many of them are sort of, they have divisions.
Okay, so let's thank our distinguished speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.